I'm Mark Halperin.
And I'm John Heilemann. And with all due respect to the revolution, which will not be televised, this 2016 presidential election will be subtweeted. He's with her, sports fans. Today, President Barack Obama made his much-anticipated full-throated endorsement of Hillary Clinton to be his successor as President of the United States. It was a day of much orchestration and fanfare at the White House, but here's the general outline of what took place. Fresh off of a bruising election night earlier on Tuesday, Bernie Sanders traveled to our nation's capital and, on his way to the Oval Office, stopped at a coffee shop for a historic scone. Then Sanders met with President Obama and afterwards spoke to reporters camped out on the White House lawn, saying that while he'll be competing in the D.C. primary next week, he'll ultimately do everything he can to stop Donald J. Trump, billionaire, from becoming the next president, signaling his eventual support for Hillary Clinton.
I spoke briefly to Secretary Clinton on Tuesday night, and I congratulated her on her very strong campaign. I look forward to meeting with her in the near future to see how we can work together to defeat Donald Trump and to create a government which represents all of us and not just the 1%.
A couple of hours after Sanders spoke came the big news of the day. The Clinton campaign released a 3-minute video produced by them in conjunction with the White House of Barack Obama expressing his unequivocal support of his 2008 rival and former Secretary of State.
I want to congratulate Hillary Clinton on making history as the presumptive Democratic nominee for President of the United States. Look, I know how hard this job can be. That's why I know Hillary will be so good at it. In fact, I don't think there's ever been someone so qualified to hold this office. She's got the courage, the compassion, and the heart to get the job done. And I say that as somebody who had to debate her more than 20 times. I am fired up, and I cannot wait to get out there and campaign for Hillary.
In fact, President Obama and Clinton are expected to hold their first joint campaign event on Wednesday in Green Bay, Wisconsin. This afternoon, our Bloomberg Politics colleague Jennifer Epstein interviewed the presumptive Democratic nominee who had this to say about getting her old boss's support.
Well, it just means so much to have a strong substantive endorsement from the president. Obviously, I value his opinion a great deal personally. And as I've said repeatedly on the campaign trail, I think he has been a very successful president who's made our country stronger and fairer. And it's just such a treat because over the years of knowing each other, we've gone from fierce competitors to true friends.
So, Mark, it's a big day on the Democratic side of the aisle. My question for you, my friend, are what do you think the immediate implications are of this endorsement for Hillary Clinton and her effort to unify the Democratic Party?
Makes it much harder for Bernie Sanders to go forward in any way. Makes it much more likely the convention in Philadelphia is united. It allows Hillary Clinton now to go starting next week to Wisconsin, but I think to lots of other battleground states with the president likely to create big splashing news events. It'll be difficult for Donald Trump to match. And it allows her to raise a lot more money with the president's help. It's a big, important move for her, and the president did it exactly the way she would have wanted because the coordination between this president and his chosen successor is tighter on a staff level than anyone in modern history.
Yes, it is the case. My understanding is that basically President Obama has been itching to do this. He talked with Bernie Sanders on Sunday. The president has wanted to endorse basically from that moment forward. He would like to have endorsed on Sunday night or Monday or Tuesday, but he was very deferential, as was the rest of the White House, to what the Clinton campaign wanted. And what the Clinton campaign wanted was for this to be orchestrated in some degree of negotiation with the Sanders campaign. They wanted to give Sanders some space and some time, but even so, the urgency of this is pretty high. And so here we are, 48 hours after those big elections on Tuesday, exactly where Barack Obama wanted to be, exactly where the Clinton campaign wanted him to be, and Senator Sanders behaving in that comment to reporters and otherwise in a pretty cooperative place. So I don't think that you could imagine this whole thing could have gone any better from Hillary Clinton's point of view, or frankly, from the Democratic Party's point of view, to be where we are right now, as I said, just 48 hours after the polls, after we got the result, basically, of the California primary.
Yeah. All right. It did not take long for Donald Trump to respond to the news of President Obama's endorsement. The presumptive Republican nominee, he turned to his favorite social media microphone and tweeted this: Obama just endorsed crooked Hillary. He wants 4 more years of Obama, but nobody else does. Clinton quickly tweeted back at Trump, writing, quote, delete your account, which is, as you know, considered by some millennials to be the ultimate Twitter diss. That tweet by Clinton has already become one of the most retweeted missive she's ever sent on the platform. Republicans are minimizing Obama's endorsement, even saying it's a negative thing. But, John, what are the implications for Trump and for Clinton in the general election from this endorsement?
Well, again, it's worth saying this, Mark. You know, there was a long period of time where we all thought that the Republican Party was in disarray, the Democratic Party was going to be united relatively easily. Then came that moment when it looked like Donald Trump was uniting the Republican Party, and the Democratic Party seemed engulfed and in disarray. Now we're back to the status quo ante. The Democratic Party is quickly moving towards unity, and the Republican Party is more is exhibiting more lack of unity than it has in many, many weeks. So it's bad for Donald Trump. The president's got an over 50% approval rating. Nothing about this good for the Republican presumptive nominee.
Yeah. If you're running against to succeed a president of your own party, there can be two areas of psychodrama. One can be with your last remaining opponent in the race, and one can be with the incumbent president. Secretary Clinton today, because of the dexterity of her campaign, basically in one fell swoop, in one news cycle, ended those two potential psychodramas.
Right. Well, and as you know, Donald Trump has been trying to make mischief for a while, suggesting that Bernie Sanders should run as an independent, that he should challenge Hillary Clinton. He'd been saying those things on the campaign trail for weeks. That's not going to happen now, quite obviously. And again, that's another element of why this is, again, it's all good for the Democratic side and nothing good about this for the Republican side. And again, it's happened more quickly, and I think it bodes well. You'll see Hillary Clinton get a polling bump, I think, pretty quickly here if this all comes together on schedule as Democrats begin to come home, as Republicans have for Trump.
Yeah, Bernie Sanders and half his donors and half the Obama donors who haven't given to Hillary Clinton give to her. That's right. A serious piece of cash. Yep. Those two guys, I think, can be enlisted before too long. President Obama right away, Bernie Sanders before too long, to help her raise money. It puts even more pressure on Donald Trump. Clinton will now have Bernie Sanders, the Clintons, her husband, the Bidens, the Obamas, all out there. Donald Trump will have surrogates, but nobody at the level that she'll have.
Yes, totally right. And look, I think the money thing can't be underestimated. You know, we're going to talk later in the show about Trump's fundraising situation. But having Barack Obama and Bernie Sanders raising money for you, that's a big deal for the Clinton campaign. Wunderbar. Wunderbar for them and wunderbar for us, all right? We'll have more from our Bloomberg Politics interview, Jen Epstein's, that is, with Hillary Clinton next, what she said, former Secretary of State, that is, about Elizabeth Warren after this very quick break.
In off the campaign trail, Bernie Sanders had a very busy day back in Washington, D.C. today. He talked about the economy and the campaign during that Oval Office meeting with President Obama. Then, after he met with reporters and told them he would do whatever it takes to help defeat Donald Trump in November, Sanders went back up to where he does his day job on Capitol Hill and met with the two top Democrats, Harry Reid and Chuck Schumer, who's expected to replace Senator Reid as the top Democrat on the Senate. Tonight, Sanders is holding a rally near Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Stadium on Capitol Hill, leading up to next Tuesday's Washington, D.C. primary, in which Sanders says he's still going to compete hard, even as he ratchets down his campaign. John, after the Obama endorsement of Clinton, and as Sanders clearly begins to ratchet down his campaign, what does he now want, and what can he get?
We have come full circle, Mark, on the Sanders campaign. We're now back to the original impetus that got him into the race in the first place, which is to try to press forward on the progressive issues that he cares about. And I think in particular, the way in which it's different from when he started, he now has really profound convictions about how he wants to change the Democratic nominating process, about the notion that he wants to have same-day easy registration, he wants to have open primaries, he wants to try to reduce, if not eliminate, the role of superdelegates. And I think Hillary Clinton is pretty likely, and the Democratic Party are pretty likely to give him what he wants, both because they recognize that those things are necessary in the new age, and also because a lot of them don't have a stake in holding on to the old system.
Yeah, you know, Secretary Clinton has gotten to this important point in the campaign, having finessed saying simultaneously that Bernie Sanders is too liberal and that they basically don't disagree about anything. He has now gotten his issues mainstreamed within her campaign,
yep,
and within the party, raising the minimum wage, true universal health care, right, reducing the influence of special interest money in politics. All those things, I think he's going to be part of helping Democrats try to hold the Senate, raising money his way for Democratic Senate candidates. And I think if the Democrats take control of the Senate, he's got a good chance to be the head of an important committee.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, the big question, you know, Sanders has always been a gadfly on Capitol Hill. He now has a lot of the Democratic leadership who, if he handles this right, as he seems to be handling it, by right I mean in a way that brings the party together as opposed to cleaving it in half, he will have a lot of chits to call in on Capitol Hill. He'll have a lot of gratitude from people like Harry Reid and Chuck Schumer and others, and he'll be able to put himself in a position to be a much bigger force in terms of actually making policy than he's ever been in his whole career in the Senate, starting in 2017, if, as you say or suggest is possible, Democrats do retake control of the upper chamber.
The other thing he's got to decide, and there's a big meeting of his supporters in Chicago later in the month, is how, as this campaign goes forward into next year, how does he want to get his message out?
Right.
Does he want to continue to do big events around the country?
Yep.
Social media, how does he want to do it?
Hillary Clinton is anticipating another big endorsement sometime in the very, very near future. Massachusetts Senator Elizabeth Warren is expected to back her party's presumptive nominee any minute now. Warren's name has long been mentioned among possible running mate options for Clinton. That chatter has escalated in recent days with reports that Senate Minority Leader Harry Reid and others are for the idea of Warren being on the ticket. Here's what Clinton had to say about Warren today in that interview with Bloomberg Politics' own Jennifer Epstein.
Well, of course, I've spoken with Senator Warren in the last few weeks. We've stayed in touch over the campaign, and I am very much looking forward to, you know, having her good advice and counsel as we move into the general election campaign. I have the highest regard for her. I also believe that my plan to rein in Wall Street was the toughest, most comprehensive in this campaign on either side. And I'll be consulting with Senator Warren and others about how we're going to actually implement it. One thing that I'm particularly focused on, which I know means a lot to Senator Warren, is protecting the Consumer Protection Bureau, and also protecting Dodd-Frank and the regulations that were put on Wall Street after the Great Recession from the promise to repeal them by Donald Trump.
Elizabeth Warren is giving a speech tonight at the American Constitution Society convention in Washington, where, according to excerpts that her office released, she will escalate her attacks on Donald Trump and the Republican leaders who still support him. And later on after that, she'll be on MSNBC's Rachel Maddow show, where she's expected to offer her endorsement for Hillary Clinton on MSNBC's air. So, Mark, my question for you, What do today's developments, the Obama endorsement, the Sanders statement to the press, and Warren's endorsement coming later tonight along with her speech, what do those things mean for the Massachusetts senator's role in the campaign ahead?
Well, Bernie Sanders eclipsed her as a spokesperson for that part of the party. Now that he's no longer going to be a presidential candidate, she gets a chance now to be back in that mix and to perhaps go back on top as the key person people turn to. She's been extraordinarily aggressive, not just going after Trump, but she just went after, she's expected to go after Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell. Ryan's office has come back at her. She's now put herself at the center of Democratic heavyweights, right under the Bidens and the Obamas and the Clintons. And I don't think either of them is going to be on the ticket, but I think she's going to be a big player along with Sanders in the fall, showing what she can do, trying to prove, can she raise money? Right. Can she get a message out? Can she be the kind of activist player in the national context that she's been on a different level up until now?
Well, as you know, Mark, I have always thought more than you have that Elizabeth Warren could be on the ticket, and I still continue to think that she could very well be on the ticket with Hillary Clinton, and here's why. Although Bernie Sanders is now moving into a position where he's going to be a unifier and not a divider of the Democratic Party, quite clearly, it still remains the case that a lot of supporters of Bernie Sanders will not necessarily do exactly what Bernie Sanders tells them just because he endorsed Hillary Clinton. They will not necessarily flock to her. She, Hillary Clinton, will still have a problem, I think, with enthusiasm among millennial voters and some progressive voters on the far left of the Democratic Party, and she's going to have to solve that problem. I still don't see an easier way of solving it than putting Elizabeth Warren on the ticket.
We'll see. I don't think so. Up next, more on Bernie Sanders' day in D.C. and that Hillary Clinton interview with our Bloomberg Politics editor colleague, Jennifer Epstein, right after this.
Joining us now are two amazing people, our Bloomberg Politics colleagues, Jennifer Epstein, who interviewed Hillary Clinton just before President Obama's endorsement was announced, and at the White House, Bloomberg's senior White House correspondent and birthday girl. Happy birthday, Margaret. Margaret Talib.
Thank you.
Who was covering 29. That Oval Office meeting between the president and Bernie Sanders. You guys are both awesome. So let me ask you this question. We already played stuff from your interview with Hillary Clinton talking about the endorsement. They're about to head out on the campaign trail. together next week, Wednesday, Green Bay, Wisconsin. Why are they going to Green Bay, and how does she feel about the prospect of getting back out on the campaign trail with Barack Obama?
Well, they're going to Green Bay because Wisconsin is one of the states that Trump certainly wants to put into play. It's been one of those battlegrounds where even though the Democrats end up winning it for the most part, it's still a place where both parties have to campaign pretty heavily. She's also just kind of trying to go after working class, white working class people, and that's a good place to start with that. And it's a specific town that Donald Trump has mentioned as a place that he wants to try to reach out to voters. So they're there, they're going, and Hillary Clinton said to me that she's really excited about it. You know, she has come from having Barack Obama be her biggest rival to being friends with him, and she seems to really be looking forward to having some fun, some joyful times on the campaign trail with him.
Also, just keep in mind, also a state that Barack Obama won emphatically in 2012, even though Paul Ryan was on the Republican ticket, and a state that Hillary Clinton lost in the Democratic nomination to Bernie Sanders, where she needs to kind of bolster herself there. Margaret, down in Washington today, tell us a little bit about what you witnessed there with Sanders. Obviously, everybody in the political world watched his statement to reporters, but give us a little sense of what the behind-the-scenes orchestration, the drama was around Senator Sanders' visit with President Obama.
It was really quite a choreography. We did know last night at the end of the day that Senator Sanders was expected, his aides expected him to come out to the stakeout location. And you could see that a few hours ago as like 75 reporters were gathered outside in the burning sun to wait. But, you know, it wasn't really clear until this morning when they began moving the press briefing back and back. And there was just that sort of magic vibe in the air that something was about to go down. This meeting with Sanders, which Sanders had requested, really was the last remaining obstacle to President Obama giving his endorsement. He had wanted to several days ago when he spoke with Senator Sanders on Sunday. That would have been the precursor to this endorsement, and President Obama was prepared really even before Tuesday night, but certainly after Tuesday night, to get out with this and move things forward. But it was the Clinton campaign that wanted to wait, feeling, and President Obama too, understanding the feeling that Senator Sanders wanted to have his own time and space to make the decision that he hasn't articulated yet, but that he is coming around to slowly but surely. And so it was a matter of giving him the deference of that meeting, talking about the grassroots, talking about Senator Sanders' ideas and how he could best move those forward, talking about the president's experience being the presumptive nominee, what he needed from Hillary Clinton 8 years ago, and trying to have that conversation to show Bernie Sanders a level of respect and inclusion that would sort of best position him to be able to go forward as part of the team. He's not quite there yet officially, but things are certainly moving in that direction.
Jennifer, talk about the human reality of the advantage that the Clinton campaign has that two of its top five officials, Jennifer Palmieri and John Podesta, used to be amongst the top officials in this White House.
Well, they've certainly been part of the conversations between the campaign and the White House going back to even before this campaign officially launched. You know, Podesta and Palmieri both left the White House not long before they joined the campaign. And since then, it's all kind of been this dynamic of, you know, that there's a constant conversations happening. And now I think we're just going to see this really, really seamless cooperation wherever and whenever and however President Obama can be used and Michelle Obama and the Bidens can be used to Hillary Clinton's advantage. You know, this is about the legacy of all the people in the current administration being able to carry it on and making sure that things like the Affordable Care Act don't get repealed, and that if anything, they're built upon and improved. And that's very much where their priorities lie moving forward.
So, Margaret, Hillary Clinton's operating kind of as the de facto heir apparent vice president, when in fact there's an actual vice president. He's got his own Bernie Sanders meeting today. What do you know about the role that Joe Biden has played in either brokering all this or being part of the discussion about how Team Obama goes forward now, easing Bernie Sanders out and working to help Hillary Clinton get elected?
Yeah, it's really interesting. That meeting has been underway at the Naval Observatory. We will see later tonight both Vice President Biden and Senator Elizabeth Warren speaking at a gathering of progressive legal activists and lawyers. We're not expecting either of them to make their endorsement there. We do understand that Senator Elizabeth Warren will make an endorsement tonight. Vice President Biden has a really special role because, of course, he didn't think that Hillary Clinton was best positioned as the Republicans' nominee several months ago. He wanted to run himself. He might very well have mounted that run himself if not for this period of time and the grieving for the passing of his son from brain cancer. And it has been a slow but steady path for Joe Biden to come around to being supportive of Hillary Clinton. He has kept his thumb off the scale. I don't think he will much longer, but he may be looking for a moment to make this sort of his own moment rather than to get ground in with the news of the day with President Obama and, you know, Senator Warren and everybody else. But Joe Biden's endorsement, when it comes, will be special because it will offer something different than what Senator Sanders can and even different than what Barack Obama can. It will offer that working class white man's vote in some circles, at least in some quarters and in some swaths of the country, most importantly, potentially in the Rust Belt in parts of Pennsylvania and Ohio.
Jim, we talked before, Mark and I did, about the power of having two of the greatest fundraisers in the history of fundraising, Bernie Sanders and Barack Obama, now out about to soon at some point in the immediate future outraising money for Hillary Clinton. Just talk about the Clinton campaign is about to start turning to that in a serious way. There's been some news about them really trying to get the donors together this month and start really raising big money to try to take advantage of Trump's weakness there. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so there's already been some calls and some early meetings. Secretary Clinton is going to have another meeting in D.C. at her house with the big dollar bundlers, the people who are raising $500,000 or more for her. And I think that what they're going to try to do is just kind of have a big shock and awe month in June and then to move forward. I mean, they're looking at this billion-dollar plus total for all the Democratic fundraising efforts. You know, as much as Trump has played it down to us and saying maybe he's not even going to raise $500 million, the Democrats know that they have to play this in the traditional way. They want to have a field operation that's strong, not just for the top of the ticket, but for the House and Senate races, the gubernatorial races, and so on. And the fundraising is all part of that, and they can just get, you know, Obama, Sanders, and Vice President Biden and Michelle Obama out there fundraising, that can go a big way. You know, Hillary Clinton's only one person. Her campaign has already started to make it clear that they're going to have her mostly focusing on the stump and not fundraising.
Jennifer Epstein, Margaret Talib, you both are great, and thanks for coming on the show. Up next, John Kasich, the Republican governor of the state hosting the GOP convention next month, is not ready to endorse his party's standard bearer. We'll tell you why after this.
Welcome back. Over the past 24 hours or so, three leading Republicans, Speaker of the House Paul Ryan of Wisconsin, the Governor of Wisconsin, Scott Walker, And John Kasich, the governor of the state of the Ohio, repudiated their presumptive nominee in the wake of his comments about the Mexican heritage of that federal judge. Among the many things Donald Trump has changed about U.S. electoral politics, this appears to be yet another new normal. On the spectrum of mildish criticism to scathing rebuke, here are just some of the sound bites that occur when a party's candidate for president is at odds with top figures in that same party.
His stage presence is something that's different than say, what I would do. But my personal interactions, I find them to have very even-handed temper. I think there's no justifying those comments, and I was very clear about that. And I think we all, everybody, not just Republicans, should disavow comments like that. And I'm glad he walked it back. This is a long campaign with a long way to go. And he has a ways to go to give us a campaign that we can all be proud of.
I'm frustrated right now. I think it's just wrong. I don't think it has any place in American society today. There's a lot of us expect, not as Republicans, but as Americans, that if you want to be viewed as a credible candidate, you need to make it clear that you don't associate with those beliefs.
The fact of the matter is that the qualities we need in a leader is very important to me. This is not a game for me. Look, I can't go for dividing, name calling, or somebody that doesn't really represent conservative principles.
John, this is remarkable stuff. My question is it sustainable for the Republican Party to have Trump speak out and people like this repudiate him, or does something have to give?
Well, I think it's sustainable in the sense that it could go on all the way through to Election Day. Is it sustainable in a context that would allow Donald Trump to win and the Republican Party to maintain control of the Senate and the House? The answer to that question, I believe, is no. But I do think that there's a chance, if Trump remains the nominee and Trump continues being Trump, that this could become not just the new normal, but it could become our way of life between now and November.
I'm going to make a prediction here that at some point soon, leading figures in the party are going to speak out and say, this has got to stop. He's our nominee. You're going to have to just be supportive of him. And you can't make every news cycle about answering the press's questions about him. You got to stop answering. And there's going to be a real conflict there because there are people like Paul Ryan and John Kasich and apparently Scott Walker who don't want to stop answering.
Well, right. And look, I mean, I think, in fact, they intend to continue to answer because they see political benefit for their members. In Ryan's case and Mitch McConnell's case, I think as long as Trump continues to create controversy, who's going to tell Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell to shut up? Who are bigger figures in the Republican Party than them?
Well, we'll see. But there's people who look at this and say it's not top Republicans who say this isn't sustainable. Not just that we can't win at the top of the ticket, but it's going to hurt everybody because it's going to be the only Republican message answering for Donald Trump on things he does and says. And what one person said to me today is, how far does it have to go? What would Trump have to say for us to no longer have to answer for him or for people to start flipping? It's a messy situation. And Trump can say he's not going to talk about this stuff anymore. But as you can see, leading figures in the party continue to talk about it.
Right. I should note that Ryan Lizza from The New Yorker just tweeted that Susan Collins, the Maine senator, told him that she may vote for Hillary Clinton, which is something we haven't heard that much from figures in the Senate. A lot of people saying they might not vote for Trump, but not many who've come out and openly said they might vote for Hillary Clinton. So that's a pretty interesting development. All right. The national finance team of Donald J. Trump, billionaire, gathered its top donors at the Four Seasons here in Gotham City today. This is the first official meeting of the joint GOP fundraising operation, and it comes at a time of skepticism that Trump will be able to reach his previously stated $1 billion goal for the general election. Ever since Trump's Judge Curiel controversy broke, one of the most restive groups in the Republican Party has been big dollar donors. So, Mark, I ask you, in the context of this meeting and everything else that's going on, what is the state of the health of Donald Trump's fundraising operation as of now?
Well, it's healthier than what some of the coverage suggests. I'm told the tone at the meeting today was very upbeat, that a lot of people there are now engaged in this and that Trump's a pretty big draw. But they're just so far behind in the mechanics of this. They don't have the kind of help like from a Barack Obama and a Bill Clinton that Hillary Clinton has. So it's got a chance to raise enough money to potentially be competitive, but they got a long way to go.
We talked a little bit about this yesterday. Donald Trump is, I do not see a way for Trump, given where he currently stands in his fundraising efforts, for him to raise enough money to run a real, sophisticated, modern, presidential campaign. And by that, I mean not just having enough money to put some ads on the air, but have real ground operations in the battleground states to do data, to do targeting, to do the kind of stuff that presidential campaigns in the 21st century do. Now, Trump can dismiss those things, as he does, and say they're not necessary, but I just don't believe you can win the presidential election without them.
Somebody pointed out today, one of our colleagues, I apologize for not remembering which, pointed out that this is the kind of meeting that in a normal presidential cycle,
yes,
the Republican nominee would have had 3 years ago.
Yeah, right.
Maybe 3 years ago. It's a problem. But the other thing is, can Trump start raising internet money? I'm fascinated by this. Hasn't gotten much attention.
Right.
But can he start raising those low-dollar donations, which come in more cheaply and which build a kind of grassroots movement that certainly any candidate would like to have?
Right. He has mastered the new media in almost every respect, and he's obviously a huge brand and a brand that apparently is very internet friendly. On the other hand, he is a multi-billionaire by his own accounting, if not everyone else's accounting. A lot of people don't like giving money to multi-billionaires.
Up next, some Republicans are once again fretting about a contentious and maybe a contested national convention in Cleveland. We'll talk about some of the long shot party rules changes that would have to occur in the politics of all that after this quick break.
Last week, Donald Trump's comments about Judge Curiel has put him on thin ice with a number of different segments of the Republican Party. That includes folks like conservative radio hosts Hugh Hewitt and Steve Deese, who are among what seems to be a growing chorus of people suggesting that maybe delegates at next month's Republican National Convention should change the rules to stop Trump's coronation if he doesn't change his behavior. How alive are those efforts and how realistic are they? To answer those questions, we are joined by two amazing guests, Republican lawyer and MSNBC political analyst Ben Ginsburg, right here in the studio with me, and from our D.C. Bureau, Tim Miller, an advisor to the anti-Trump Our Principles PAC and former communications director for Jeb Bush's presidential campaign. Gentlemen, good to see you. Ben, you have been on television, rules maestro that you are, famous electoral thief. Guy who knows how to work the system. You've been on television saying, this can't happen, won't happen, very unlikely to happen. Just explain why you are so pessimistic, even as the voices for a potentially a dump Trump thing at the convention get louder.
This is not a pessimism optimism. Right. This is simply the political reality. The rules change itself. How to do it mechanically, not terribly difficult. The political will to make history at a convention is much more difficult.
Right. So just to disentangle that for 1 second. Forget about the political will. Let's set that aside. Just in terms of the rules, just in terms of what would be required, you're saying that's not the hard part.
No, there are a couple of different ways being floated. To me, the easiest way is to take the rule that says you need a majority of delegates, and you would make that a supermajority of delegates for the first ballot. Delegates become unbound on the second ballot. Right. Simple word change.
Right. So Trump would then need like 2/3 of the delegates to get the ballot, to get the nomination.
Yeah. Any candidate
like
would. Right.
Okay.
Right.
Tim. To the question that Ben just raised, which is the question of political will. I know you have your finger on the pulse of this, of the Never Trump and now the Dump Trump movement. Tell me about what you think of that. Is there the political will out there to make history at the Republican convention?
Look, I think at this point it's probably unlikely, but there's increasing interest. And as to Ben's point, the mechanics of this are easy enough that if Donald Trump continues to have a couple of bad weeks, I expect that his polling to tank over the next few weeks as Hillary Clinton unites the Democrat Party and begins to get Bernie supporters into her fold. So I think the will could be there. I know that at least one or two members of the Rules Committee have expressed interest in this. And look, from my perspective, if you're of the view that Donald Trump is just a standard Republican nominee in the mold of Mitt Romney or Ronald Reagan or whatever, I understand Ben's point. This seems too extreme to do. But if you're of the view that Donald Trump is a threat to the party and to the Republic, he's anti-GOP platform, anti-Constitution, why would you not want to make a change that would give every delegate the opportunity to vote their conscience? And I think if you did that, Trump would probably still be the nominee, but I think that's the right thing to do for the party and for the delegates.
Guys, I'm going to ask you to engage in a hypothetical. I don't want anyone getting mad. I'm just trying to test the system here, so don't get mad.
Can't wait for this question.
Yeah, no promises.
Take this away from Donald Trump and the things he's done that have created so much controversy and raised the question we're discussing. Clearly, if the Republican nominee killed a person right now, right, then the delegates would be, the people on the committee would say, well, of course we have to find a way, even though the person got a majority, we have to find a way to bring the nomination to someone else, right?
You mean, or if a candidate got indicted, you would expect a convention to do something wild, hypothetical?
Something like that. So here's my question. Leaving aside the political environment, the media environment, what do you think what kind of offense that could actually be committed by this nominee might change your judgment about whether it was possible?
Well, I'm not sure there is any. I mean, what I'm talking about is you need the leadership to be able to organize not only the Rules Committee of the convention, but the 2,472 delegates themselves. That group doesn't even gather together until the convention starts. So, number one, you would need to see political leadership and somebody who the delegates would actually listen to, and I'm not sure anyone's identified who those people are, combined with the need in the hothouse atmosphere of the convention to actually be able to form a whip system to get the delegates to do something like that.
Okay, Tim?
Yeah, Mark, I think my answer to that is I think that Ben, with all respect, is being kind of limited by what is possible here from a mechanical perspective. This has been an unprecedented year. Donald Trump is an unprecedented candidate, and I think that if the delegates themselves, I know Ted Cruz has over 800 delegates, they could organize amongst themselves and have enough power to make this happen. And in answer to your hypothetical, I think that Donald Trump has already done everything that would need to be done for this to be on the table, and I think the only thing that would have to change for it to become realistic is his viability. I think his poll numbers are basically the only reason why there aren't more prominent people talking about this right now.
Ben,
Tim Miller just accused you of having a deadly lack of political imagination, basically, right? Is that the truth, that you are basically, you're just totally limited by conventional thinking?
I like to think that I see the entire horizon, although maybe not as broad as Tim, as Tim is seeing right now. I've been on the Rules Committee, I've worked conventions before. I think that setting up a whip operation to be able to achieve something historic like that is just really difficult, and you do need the leadership from the top and a cause. And so I've not seen that either from the leadership of the Republican National Committee or enough elected leaders who actually have the influence with who the delegates are.
Tim, let me ask.
I agree it's difficult. I think Cruz would be the person that could do it.
Right. Tim, let me ask you this question.
In theory.
Let me ask you this question. We had a lot of efforts that went around in the Never Trump movement to try to find a third-party independent candidate. There's discussion about Romney, discussion about others. David French, now David French is out. Where does that stand right now? Put aside the question of dump Trump at the convention. Is there any renewed interest in trying to go back to other the original people that people tried to get in or to others and say, we even need this, we need an independent candidate even more than ever now to stop Trump?
I think that there's interest in it. Speaking for on behalf of our principals PAC, you know, our effort was always focused on the nomination, and the Ricketts family that funds us, they were never really interested in a third party bid because of all the challenges that go along with that. It's, you know, the Texas deadline is now, you know, an issue having passed. So I mean, there are major questions with a third party bid. You know, never say never in this political environment, but it seems unlikely to me.
All right, Tim Miller. Despite how rude you were to Ben Ginsburg, it was great to have you.
I love actually, Ben Ginsburg.
Actually, I'd say probably probably because of how rude you were, it was great to have you. Ben Ginsburg, your first time on this set, we love you, and it's great that you were here, so thank you. Coming up, we head a few blocks over to Trump Tower, where Katie Turr, the great Katie Turr, is standing by. We'll be right back with that.
As we said, today Donald Trump met with top GOP bundlers to discuss his general election fundraising efforts. Here to tell us about that meeting and all things Trump, NBC News correspondent Katie Turr, who joins us from outside Trump Tower, where she has worn a groove into the ground because she stands there a lot. So Katie, I've heard mixed things about
cold
the meeting,
too.
It's cold. Cold in June. I've heard mixed things about the meeting, but one person who's usually pretty reliable suggested to me that the donors were actually pretty upbeat and they like the schedule that's coming together. They like Trump's seeming enthusiasm about raising money.
You know, I heard the same thing from two sources who were inside that meeting who said that they felt that Donald Trump had a pretty warm reception from those donors. Certainly the Trump campaign was positive about it when they left. They talked about how they're going to raise the amount of money they need to raise. Corey Lewandowski walked out without talking to reporters and said, just telling us how good the chicken was at the Four Seasons, but with a big smile on his face. I'm also told that Donald Trump was going to talk about, or did talk about, the electoral map and what states he wants to put in play, Maryland being on it. That's a new state that we have not heard. And I'm also told that Ryan's previous stress that any money you don't give to Trump is money that you're basically giving to Hillary Clinton. He, on the other hand, left through a back door or something and avoided the press altogether. But when he was going in, I did get a chance to ask him how he felt Donald Trump was doing. He gave me a thumbs up. Other than the donors that were in that room, I talked to a big-time money manager who represents a lot of the normal GOP donors, some of whom decided not to go to this event. And he told me that the reason he told them not to do it was, frankly, because they don't want their names associated with Donald Trump at this particular moment, especially after the Judge Curiel comments. These are folks that have stakes in public companies that can't have their names associated with somebody who's being accused of racism. In the words of the money manager, it's not only morally reprehensible, it's bad for business.
Okay, there's all these areas where people are saying maybe it was good enough to win the nomination, but maybe it's not good enough to win a general. You have the Obama endorsement of Clinton. You have this USA Today story about Trump allegedly not paying people he owed money to, including, you know, workers who aren't wealthy by any means. And most of the response is either no response or some Trump tweets. What's your sense of how the campaign views its rapid response operation?
Today is a perfect example, and I'm going to take my stick mic because we're on a New York City street, so you can hear me better. But I think today is a perfect example of how the Donald Trump campaign does not have a communications team or a rapid response team in place. The Donald Trump tweets towards Hillary Clinton getting the Obama endorsement were the extent of the campaign's rapid response. The RNC came out with some of their own, but usually in this scenario, somebody like Romney or even Hillary Clinton now would have a whole team of folks out there trying to spin their version of the message. As for the USA Today article, which is extraordinarily damning. They talked to over, they reviewed over 60 lawsuits, hundreds of liens, the number of government filings and judgments, and found that Donald Trump has a history and a pattern of not paying small businesses that contracted with him, even having to put out, even one cabinet maker who had his company in his family for three generations. That cabinet maker had to go into bankruptcy after dealing with Donald Trump. Donald Trump not paying him about $83,000 for work on a casino. This is a pretty damning report for somebody whose message is, I'm for the little guy, I'm for job creation, I'm for making this country great again by giving folks what they haven't gotten in the past decade or so, which is better paying jobs. So far, we haven't had any response from the campaign whatsoever. There's been no spin on this, and it's likely to be a story that's going to only snowball from here. So this is a very good example of how the campaign is still caught flat-footed when there is negative stories about them.
Katie, do you think it's Heilemann here? Do you think that there's another example of that? It has to do with the Hillary Clinton tweet today, instructing Trump to, or suggesting that Trump should delete his Twitter account. Do you think that they handled that as smoothly as they might?
You know, I actually do think they did. I think the tweets from both Ryan's Priebus and from Sean Spicer were both quite good and quite on message for the campaign. They've been talking about this email scandal now for a long time. This is one of the things that they're going to hit her on as much as they possibly can. Going to try and paint her as somebody who's not only untrustworthy, but somebody who's broken the law. So that was certainly on message. Donald Trump getting on that message as well. It is an example, one of the first examples of cohesiveness between Donald Trump and the campaign. So I think that was a positive reaction. But, you know, in other circumstances, if this was the Hillary Clinton campaign or even the Romney campaign, they'd be coming out with a lot more. Surrogates would be talking about it. We'd get more emails. And there would certainly just be, they'd flood the zone on this issue.
Katie, we only got about 30 more seconds. Just give me a sense when Donald Trump talked about giving a speech about the politics of personal enrichment, attacking the Clintons. He says he's going to do that next week. Do we know anything more about where that speech is going to happen, when it's going to happen, what's going to be in it?
We are hearing that that speech is going to happen in New Hampshire, but it could potentially also happen in Washington, D.C., at his golf course down there. That's what he told some reporters. We don't know yet. In terms of what's in that speech, we've asked the campaign for a little bit more detail, and all they've told us is to look into the Clinton Foundation. We've asked what specifically about the Clinton Foundation, and the response from Corey Lewandowski was, you're a big news organization. I'm sure you can figure it out.
Katie Turr of both NBC News and Fifth Avenue, thank you very much. Don't forget, if you're watching us in Washington, D.C., you can also listen to us anytime live on the radio on Bloomberg 99.1. We'll be right back.
One last thing before we go. Earlier, I mentioned a tweet by The New Yorker's Ryan Lizza about GOP Senator Susan Collins being open to voting for Hillary Clinton. That story has now been posted. Just to be clear, Collins says she doesn't anticipate voting for Clinton, but she then goes on to say, quote, I'm not going to say never, end quote. Head over to BloombergPolitics.com and check out a new Business Week story by Josh Green and Tim Higgins about the negative ad war we can expect in the general election. Coming up on Bloomberg TV, Emily Chang talks to legendary tech venture capitalist Vinod Khosla. That's on Bloomberg West. Until tomorrow, from me and my friend Mark Halperin, we say to you, sayonara.
for dividing, name-calling, or somebody that doesn't really represent conservative principles.
John, this is remarkable stuff. My question is it sustainable for the Republican Party to have Trump speak out and people like this repudiate him, or does something have to give?
Well, I think it's sustainable in the sense that it could go on all the way through to Election Day. Is it sustainable in a context that would allow Donald Trump to win and the Republican Party to maintain control of the Senate and the House? The answer to that question, I believe, is no. But I do think that there's a chance, if Trump remains the nominee and Trump continues being Trump, that this could become not just the new normal, but it could become our way of life between now and November.
I'm going to make a prediction here that at some point soon, leading figures in the party are going to speak out and say, this has got to stop. He's our nominee. You're going to have to just be supportive of him. And you can't make every news cycle about answering the press's questions about him. You got to stop answering. And there's going to be a real conflict there because there are people like Paul Ryan and John Kasich and apparently Scott Walker who don't want to stop answering.
Well, right. And look, I mean, I think, in fact, they intend to continue to answer because they see political benefit for their members. In Ryan's case and Mitch McConnell's case, I think as long as Trump continues to create controversy, who's going to tell Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell to shut up? Who are bigger figures in the Republican Party than them?
Well, we'll see. But there's people who look at this and say it's not top Republicans who say this isn't sustainable. Not just that we can't win at the top of the ticket, but it's going to hurt everybody because it's going to be the only Republican message answering for Donald Trump on things he does and says. And what one person said to me today is, how far does it have to go? What would Trump have to say for us to no longer have to answer for him or for people to start flipping? It's a messy situation. And Trump can say he's not going to talk about this stuff anymore. But as you can see, leading figures in the party continue to talk about it.
Right. I should note that Ryan Lizza from The New Yorker just tweeted that Susan Collins, the Maine senator, told him that she may vote for Hillary Clinton, which is something we haven't heard that much from figures in the Senate. A lot of people saying they might not vote for Trump, but not many who've come out and openly said they might vote for Hillary Clinton. So that's a pretty interesting development. All right. The national finance team of Donald J. Trump, billionaire, gathered its top donors at the Four Seasons here in Gotham City today. This is the first official meeting of the joint GOP fundraising operation, and it comes at a time of skepticism that Trump will be able to reach his previously stated $1 billion goal for the general election. Ever since Trump's Judge Curiel controversy broke, one of the most restive groups in the Republican Party has been big dollar donors. So, Mark, I ask you, in the context of this meeting and everything else that's going on, what is the state of the health of Donald Trump's fundraising operation as of now?
Well, it's healthier than what some of the coverage suggests. I'm told the tone at the meeting today was very upbeat, that a lot of people there are now engaged in this and that Trump's a pretty big draw. But they're just so far behind in the mechanics of this. They don't have the kind of help like from a Barack Obama and a Bill Clinton that Hillary Clinton has. So it's got a chance to raise enough money to potentially be competitive, but they got a long way to go.
We talked a little bit about this yesterday. Donald Trump is, I do not see a way for Trump, given where he currently stands in his fundraising efforts, for him to raise enough money to run a real, sophisticated, modern presidential campaign. And by that I mean not just having enough money to put some ads on the air, but have real ground operations in the battleground states to do data, to do targeting, to do the kind of stuff that presidential campaigns in the 21st century do. Now, Trump can dismiss those things, as he does, and say they're not necessary, but I just don't believe you can win the presidential election without him.
Somebody pointed out today, one of our colleagues, I apologize for not remembering which, pointed out that this is the kind of meeting that in a normal presidential cycle,
yes,
the Republican nominee would have had 3 years ago.
Yeah, right.
Maybe 3 years ago.
Yeah,
it's a problem. But the other thing is, can Trump start raising internet money? I'm fascinated by this. Hasn't gotten much attention.
Right.
But can he start raising those low-dollar donations, which come in more cheaply and which build a kind of grassroots movement that certainly any candidate would like to have?
Right. He has mastered the new media in almost every respect, and he's obviously a huge brand and a brand that apparently is very internet friendly. On the other hand, he is a multi-billionaire by his own accounting, if not everyone else's accounting. A lot of people don't like giving money to multi-billionaires.
Up next, some Republicans are once again fretting about a contentious and maybe a contested national convention in Cleveland. We'll talk about some of the long shot party rules changes that would have to occur in the politics of all that after this quick break.
Over the past week, Donald Trump's comments about Judge Curiel has put him on thin ice with a number of different segments of the Republican Party. That includes folks like conservative radio hosts Hugh Hewitt and Steve Deese, who are among what seems to be a growing chorus of people suggesting that maybe delegates at next month's Republican National Convention should change the rules, stop Trump's coronation, if he doesn't change his behavior. How alive are those efforts and how realistic are they? To answer those questions, we are joined by two amazing guests, Republican lawyer and MSNBC political analyst Ben Ginsburg, right here in the studio with me, and from our D.C. Bureau, Tim Miller, an advisor to the anti-Trump Our Principles PAC and former communications director for Jeb Bush's presidential campaign. Gentlemen, good to see you. Ben, you have been on television, rules maestro that you are, famous electoral thief, guy who knows how to work the system. You've been on television saying this can't happen, won't happen, very unlikely to happen. Just explain why you are so pessimistic, even as the voices for potentially a dump Trump thing at the convention get louder.
This is not a pessimism optimism. Right. This is simply the political reality. The rules change itself. How to do it mechanically? Not terribly difficult. The political will to make history at a convention is much more difficult.
Right. So just to disentangle that for 1 second. Forget about the political will. Let's set that aside. Just in terms of the rules, just in terms of what would be required, you're saying that's not the hard part.
No, there are a couple of different ways being floated. To me, the easiest way is to take the rule that says you need a majority of delegates, and you would make that a supermajority of delegates for the first ballot. Delegates become unbound on the second ballot. Right. Simple word change.
Right. So Trump would then need like 2/3 of the delegates to get the ballot, to get the nomination.
Any candidate
like
would. Right.
Okay.
Right.
Tim, to the question that Ben just raised, which is the question of political will. I know you have your finger on the pulse of this, of the Never Trump and now the Dump Trump movement. Tell me about what you think of that. Is there the political will out there to make history at the Republican convention?
I think at this point it's probably unlikely, but there's increasing interest. And as to Ben's point, the mechanics of this are easy enough that if Donald Trump continues to have a couple of bad weeks, I expect that his polling to tank over the next few weeks as Hillary Clinton unites the Democrat Party and begins to get Bernie supporters into her fold. So I think the will could be there. I know that at least one or two members of the Rules Committee have expressed interest in this. And look, from my perspective, if you're of the view that Donald Trump is just a standard Republican nominee in the mold of Mitt Romney or Ronald Reagan or whatever, I understand Ben's point. This seems too extreme to do. But if you're of the view that Donald Trump is a threat to the party and to the Republic, he's anti-GOP platform, anti-Constitution, why would you not want to make a change that would give every delegate the opportunity to vote their conscience? And I think if you did that, Trump would probably still be the nominee, but I think that's the right thing to do for the party and for the delegates.
Guys, I'm going to ask you to engage in a hypothetical. I don't want anyone getting mad. I'm just trying to test the system here, so don't get mad.
Can't wait for this question.
Yeah, no promises.
Take this away from Donald Trump and the things he's done that have created so much controversy and raised the question we're discussing. Clearly, if the Republican nominee killed a person right now, right, then the delegates would be, the people on the committee would say, well, of course we have to find a way, even though the person got a majority, we have to find a way to bring the nomination to someone else, right?
You mean, or if a candidate got indicted, you would expect a convention to do something wild, hypothetical?
Something like that. So here's my question. Leaving aside the political environment, the media environment, what do you think what kind of offense that could actually be committed by this nominee might change your judgment about whether it was possible?
Well, I'm not sure there is any. I mean, what I'm talking about is you need the leadership to be able to organize not only the Rules Committee of the convention, but the 2,472 delegates themselves. That group doesn't even gather together until the convention starts. So, number one, you would need to see political leadership and somebody who the delegates would actually listen to, and I'm not sure anyone's identified who those people are, combined with the need in the hot-held atmosphere of the convention to actually be able to form a whip system to get the delegates to do something like that.
Okay, Tim?
Yeah, Mark, I think my answer to that is I think that Ben, with all respect, is being kind of limited by what is possible here from a mechanical perspective. This has been an unprecedented year. Donald Trump's an unprecedented candidate. And I think that if the delegates themselves, I know Ted Cruz has over 800 delegates, they could organize amongst themselves and have enough power to make this happen. And in answer to your hypothetical, I think that Donald Trump has already done everything that would need to be done for this to be on the table. And I think the only thing that would have to change for it to become realistic is his viability. I think his poll numbers are basically the only reason why there aren't more prominent people talking about this right now.
Ben, Tim Miller just accused you of having a deadly lack of political imagination, basically, right? Is that the truth, that you are basically, you're just totally limited by conventional thinking?
I like to think that I see the entire horizon, although maybe not as broad as Tim, as Tim is seeing right now. I've been on the Rules Committee, I've worked conventions before. I think that setting up a whip operation to be able to achieve something historic like that is just really difficult, and you do need the leadership from the top and a cause. And so I've not seen that either from the leadership of the Republican National Committee or enough elected leaders who actually have the influence with who the delegates are.
Tim, let me ask.
I agree it's difficult. I think Cruz would be the person that could do it.
Right. Tim, let me ask you this question.
In theory.
Let me ask you this question. We had a lot of efforts that went around in the Never Trump movement to try to find a third-party independent candidate. There's discussion about Romney, discussion about others. David French, now David French is out. Where does that stand right now? Put aside the question of dump Trump at the convention. Is there any renewed interest in trying to go back to the original people that people tried to get in or to others and say, we even need this, we need an independent candidate even more than ever now to stop Trump?
I think that there's interest in it. Speaking for on behalf of our principals pack, you know, our effort was always focused on the nomination, and the Ricketts family that funds us, they were never really interested in a third party bid because of all the challenges that go along with that. It's, you know, the Texas deadline is now, you know, an issue having passed. So I mean, there are major questions with a third party bid. You know, never say never in this political environment, but it seems unlikely to me.
All right, Tim Miller. Despite how rude you were to Ben Ginsburg, it was great to have you.
I love Ben Ginsburg.
Actually, I'd say probably because of how rude you were, it was great to have you. Ben Ginsburg, your first time on this set, we love you, and it's great that you were here, so thank you. Coming up, we had a few blocks over to Trump Tower where Katie Turr, the great Katie Turr, is standing by. We'll be right back with that.
As we said, today Donald Trump met with top GOP bundlers to discuss his general election fundraising efforts. Here to tell us about that meeting and all things Trump, NBC News correspondent Katie Turr, who joins us from outside Trump Tower, where she has worn a groove into the ground because she stands there a lot. So, Katie, I've heard mixed things about the meeting, it's cold. Cold in June. I've heard mixed things about the meeting, but one person who's usually pretty reliable suggested to me that the donors were actually pretty upbeat and they liked the schedule that's coming together. They liked Trump's seeming enthusiasm about raising money.
You know, I heard the same thing from two sources who were inside that meeting who said that they felt that Donald Trump had a pretty warm reception from those donors. Certainly the Trump campaign was positive about it when they left. They talked about how they're going to raise the amount of money they need to raise. Corey Lewandowski walked out without talking to reporters and said just telling us how good the chicken was at the Four Seasons, but with a big smile on his face. I'm also told that Donald Trump was going to talk about the electoral map and what states he wants to put in play, Maryland being on it. That's a new state that we have not heard. And I'm also told that Ryan's Priebus stressed that any money you don't give to Trump is money that you're basically giving to Hillary Clinton. He, on the other hand, left through a back door or something and avoided the press altogether. But when he was going in, I did get a chance to ask him how he felt Donald Trump was doing. He gave me a thumbs up. Other than the donors that were in that room, I talked to a big-time money manager who represents a lot of the normal GOP donors, some of whom decided not to go to this event. And he told me that the reason he told them not to do it was, frankly, because they don't want their names associated with Donald Trump at this particular moment, especially after the Judge Curiel comments. These are folks that have stakes in public companies that can't have their names associated with somebody who's being accused of racism. In the words of the money manager, it's not only morally reprehensible, it's bad for business.
So, Kay, there's all these areas where people are saying maybe it was good enough to win the nomination, but maybe it's not good enough to win a general. You have the Obama endorsement of Clinton. You have this USA Today story about Trump allegedly not paying people he owed money to, including, you know, workers who aren't wealthy by any means. And most of the response is either no response or some Trump tweets. What's your sense of how the campaign views its rapid response operation?
Today is a perfect example, and I'm going to take my stick mic because we're on a New York City street, so you can hear me better. But I think today is a perfect example of how the Donald Trump campaign does not have a communications team or a rapid response team in place. The Donald Trump tweets towards Hillary Clinton getting the Obama endorsement were the extent of the campaign's rapid response. The RNC came out with some of their own, but usually in this scenario, somebody like Romney or even Hillary Clinton now would have a whole team of folks out there trying to spin their version of the message. As for the USA Today article, which is extraordinarily damning. They talked to reviewed over 60 lawsuits, hundreds of liens, the number of government filings and judgments, and found that Donald Trump has a history and a pattern of not paying small businesses that contracted with him, even having to put out even.
In off the campaign trail, Bernie Sanders had a very busy day back in Washington, D.C. today. He talked about the economy and the campaign during that Oval Office meeting with President Obama. Then, after he met with reporters and told them he would do whatever it takes to help defeat Donald Trump in November, Sanders went back up to where he does his day job on Capitol Hill and met with the two top Democrats, Harry Reid and Chuck Schumer, who's expected to replace Senator Reid as the top Democrat on the Senate. Tonight, Sanders is holding a rally near Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Stadium on Capitol Hill, leading up to next Tuesday's Washington, D.C. primary, in which Sanders says he's still going to compete hard, even as he ratchets down his campaign. John, after the Obama endorsement of Clinton, and as Sanders clearly begins to ratchet down his campaign, what does he now want, and what can he get?
We have come full circle, Mark, on the Sanders campaign. We're now back to the original impetus that got him into the race in the first place, which is to try to press forward on on the progressive issues that he cares about. And I think in particular, the way in which it's different from when he started, he now has really profound convictions about how he wants to change the Democratic nominating process, about the notion that he wants to have same-day easy registration. He wants to have open primaries. He wants to try to reduce, if not eliminate, the role of superdelegates. And I think Hillary Clinton is pretty likely, and the Democratic Party are pretty likely to give him what he wants, both because they recognize that those things are necessary in the new age, and also because a lot of them don't have a stake in holding on to the old system.
Yeah. You know, Secretary Clinton has gotten to this important point in the campaign, having finessed saying simultaneously that Bernie Sanders is too liberal and that they basically don't disagree about anything. He has now gotten his issues mainstreamed within her campaign and within the party. Raising the minimum wage, true universal health care, reducing the influence of special interest money in politics. All those things, I think he's going to be part of helping Democrats try to hold the Senate, raising money his way for Democratic Senate candidates. And I think if the Democrats take control of the Senate, he's got a good chance to be the head of an important committee.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, the big question, you know, Sanders has always been a gadfly on Capitol Hill. He now has a lot of the Democratic leadership who, if he handles this right, as he seems to be handling it, by right I mean in a way that brings the party together as opposed to cleaving it in half, he will have a lot of chits to call in on Capitol Hill. He'll have a lot of gratitude from people like Harry Reid and Chuck Schumer and others, and he'll be able to put himself in a position to be a much bigger force in terms of actually making policy than he's ever been in his whole career in the Senate, starting in 2017, if, as you say or suggest is possible, Democrats do retake control of the upper chamber.
The other thing he's got to decide, and there's a big meeting of his supporters in Chicago later in the month, is how, as this campaign goes forward into next year, how does he want to get his message out?
Right.
Does he want to continue to do big events around the country? Yep. Social media, how does he want to do it?
All right. Hillary Clinton is anticipating another big endorsement sometime in the very, very near future. Massachusetts Senator Elizabeth Warren is expected to back her party's presumptive nominee any minute now. Warren's name has long been mentioned among possible running mate options for Clinton. That chatter has escalated in recent days with reports that Senate Minority Leader Harry Reid and others are for the idea of Warren being on the ticket. Here's what Clinton had to say about Warren today in that interview with Bloomberg Politics' own Jennifer Epstein.
Well, of course, I've spoken with Senator Warren in the last few weeks. We've stayed in touch over the campaign, and I am very much looking forward to, you know, having her good advice and counsel as we move into the general election campaign. I have the highest regard for her. I also believe that my plan to rein in Wall Street was the toughest, most comprehensive in this campaign on either side. And I'll be consulting with Senator Warren and others about how we're going to actually implement it. One thing that I'm particularly focused on, which I know means a lot to Senator Warren, is protecting the Consumer Protection Bureau, and also protecting Dodd-Frank and the regulations that were put on Wall Street after the Great Recession from the promise to repeal them by Donald Trump.
Elizabeth Warren is giving a speech tonight at the American Constitution Society convention in Washington, where, according to excerpts that her office released, she will escalate her attacks on Donald Trump and the Republican leaders who still support him. And later on after that, she'll be on MSNBC's Rachel Maddow show, where she's expected to offer her endorsement for Hillary Clinton on MSNBC's air. So, Mark, my question for you, what do today's developments, the Obama endorsement, the Sanders statement to the press, and Warren's endorsement coming later tonight along with her speech, what do those things mean for the Massachusetts senator's role in the campaign ahead?
Well, Bernie Sanders eclipsed her as a spokesperson for that part of the party. Now that he's no longer going to be a presidential candidate, she gets a chance now to be back in that mix and to perhaps go back on top as the key person people turn to. She's been extraordinarily aggressive, not just going after Trump, but she just went after, she's expected to go after Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell. Ryan's office has come back at her. She's now put herself at the center of Democratic heavyweights, right under the Bidens and the Obamas and the Clintons. And I don't think either of them's going to be on the ticket, but I think she's going to be a big player along with Sanders in the fall, showing what she can do, trying to prove, can she raise money?
Right.
Can she get a message out? Can she be the kind of activist player in the national context that she's been on a different level up until now?
Well, as you know, Mark, I have always thought more than you have that Elizabeth Warren could be on the ticket, and I still continue to think that she could very well be on the ticket with Hillary Clinton. And here's why. Although Bernie Sanders is now moving into a position where he's going to be a unifier and not a divider of the Democratic Party, quite clearly, it still remains the case that a lot of supporters of Bernie Sanders will not necessarily do exactly what Bernie Sanders tells them just because he endorsed Hillary Clinton. They will not necessarily flock to her. She, Hillary Clinton, will still have a problem, I think, with enthusiasm among millennial voters and some progressive voters on the far left of the Democratic Party, and she's going to have to solve that problem. I still don't see an easier way of solving it than putting Elizabeth Warren on the ticket.
We'll see. I don't think so. Up next, more on Bernie Sanders' day in D.C. and that Hillary Clinton interview with our Bloomberg Politics editor colleague, Jennifer Epstein, right after this.
Joining us now are two amazing people, our Bloomberg Politics colleagues, Jennifer Epstein, who interviewed Hillary Clinton just before President Obama's endorsement was announced, and at the White House, Bloomberg's senior White House correspondent and birthday girl. Happy birthday, Margaret. Margaret Talib.
Thank you.
Who was covering 29. That Oval Office meeting between the president and Bernie Sanders. You guys are both awesome. So let me ask you this question. We already played stuff from your interview with Hillary Clinton talking about the endorsement. They're about to head out on the campaign trail together next week, Wednesday, Green Bay, Wisconsin. Why are they going to Green Bay, and how does she feel about the prospect of getting back out on the campaign trail with Barack Obama?
Well, they're going to Green Bay because Wisconsin is one of the states that Trump certainly wants to put into play. It's been one of those battlegrounds where even though the Democrats end up winning it for the most part, it's still a place where both parties have to campaign pretty heavily. She's also just kind of trying to go after working class, white working class people, and that's a good place to start with that. And it's a specific town, that city that Hillary Clinton.
I'm Mark Halperin.
And I'm John Heilemann. And with all due respect to the revolution, which will not be televised, this 2016 presidential election will be subtweeted. He's with her, sports fans, today. President Barack Obama made his much-anticipated full-throated endorsement of Hillary Clinton to be his successor as President of the United States. It was a day of much orchestration and fanfare at the White House, but here's the general outline of what took place. Fresh off of a bruising election night earlier on Tuesday, Bernie Sanders traveled to our nation's capital and, on his way to the Oval Office, stopped at a coffee shop for a historic scone. Then Sanders met with President Obama and afterwards spoke to reporters camped out on the White House lawn, saying that while he'll be competing in the D.C. primary next week, he'll ultimately do everything he can to stop Donald J. Trump, billionaire, from becoming the next president, signaling his eventual support for Hillary Clinton.
I spoke briefly to Secretary Clinton on Tuesday night, and I congratulated her on her very strong campaign. I look forward to meeting with her in the near future to see how we can work together to defeat Donald Trump and to create a government which represents all of us and not just the 1%.
A couple of hours after Sanders spoke came the big news of the day. The Clinton campaign released a 3-minute video produced by them in conjunction with the White House of Barack Obama expressing his unequivocal support of his 2008 rival and former Secretary of State.
I want to congratulate Hillary Clinton on making history as the presumptive Democratic nominee for President of the United States. Look, I know how hard this job can be. That's why I know Hillary will be so good at it. In fact, I don't think there's ever been someone so qualified to hold this office. She's got the courage, the compassion, and the heart to get the job done. And I say that as somebody who had to debate her more than 20 times. I am fired up, and I cannot wait to get out there and campaign for Hillary.
In fact, President Obama and Clinton are expected to hold their first joint campaign event on Wednesday in Green Bay, Wisconsin. This afternoon, our Bloomberg Politics colleague Jennifer Epstein interviewed the presumptive Democratic nominee who had this to say about getting her old boss's support.
Well, it just means so much to have a strong substantive endorsement from the president. Obviously, I value his opinion a great deal personally. And as I've said repeatedly on the campaign trail, I think he has been a very successful president who's made our country stronger and fairer. And it's just such a treat because over the years of knowing each other, we've gone from fierce competitors to true friends.
So, Mark, it's a big day on the Democratic side of the aisle. My question for you, my friend, are what do you think the immediate implications are of this endorsement for Hillary Clinton and her effort to unify the Democratic Party?
Makes it much harder for Bernie Sanders to go forward in any way. Makes it much more likely the convention in Philadelphia is united. It allows Hillary Clinton now to go starting next week to Wisconsin, but I think to lots of other battleground states with the president likely, to create big splashing news events. It'll be difficult for Donald Trump to match. And it allows her to raise a lot more money with the president's help. It's a big, important move for her, and the president did it exactly the way she would have wanted because the coordination between this president and his chosen successor is tighter on a staff level than anyone in modern history.
Yes, it is the case. My understanding is that basically President Obama has been itching to do this. He talked with Bernie Sanders on Sunday. The president has wanted to endorse basically from that moment forward. He would like to have endorsed on Sunday night or Monday or Tuesday, but he was very deferential, as was the rest of the White House, to what the Clinton campaign wanted. And what the Clinton campaign wanted was for this to be orchestrated in some degree of negotiation with the Sanders campaign. They wanted to give Sanders some space and some time. But even so, the urgency of this is pretty high. And so here we are, 48 hours after those big elections on Tuesday, exactly where Barack Obama wanted to be, exactly where the Clinton campaign wanted him to be, and Senator Sanders behaving in that comment to reporters and otherwise in a pretty cooperative place. So I don't think that you could imagine this whole thing could have gone any better from Hillary Clinton's point of view, or frankly from the Democratic Party's point of view, to be where we are right now, as I said, just 48 hours after the polls, after we got the result, basically, of the California primary.
Yeah. All right. It did not take long for Donald Trump to respond to the news of President Obama's endorsement. The presumptive Republican nominee turned to his favorite social media microphone and tweeted this: Obama just endorsed crooked Hillary. He wants 4 more years of Obama, but nobody else does. Clinton quickly tweeted back at Trump, writing, quote, delete your account, which is, as you know, considered by some millennials to be the ultimate Twitter diss. That tweet by Clinton has already become one of the most retweeted missive she's ever sent on the platform. Republicans are minimizing Obama's endorsement, even saying it's a negative thing. But, John, What are the implications for Trump and for Clinton in the general election from this endorsement?
Well, again, it's worth saying this, Mark. You know, there was a long period of time where we all thought that the Republican Party was in disarray. The Democratic Party was going to be united relatively easily. Then came that moment when it looked like Donald Trump was uniting the Republican Party, and the Democratic Party seemed engulfed and in disarray. Now we're back to the status quo ante. The Democratic Party is quickly moving towards unity, and the Republican Party is more is exhibiting more lack of unity than it has in many, many weeks. So it's bad for Donald Trump. The president's got an over 50% approval rating. Nothing about this good for the Republican presumptive nominee.
Yeah. If you're running against to succeed a president of your own party, there can be two areas of psychodrama. One can be with your last remaining opponent in the race, and one can be with the incumbent president. Secretary Clinton today, because of the dexterity of her campaign, basically in one fell swoop, in one news cycle, ended those two potential psychodramas.
Right. Right. Well, and as you know, Donald Trump has been trying to make mischief for a while, suggesting that Bernie Sanders should run as an independent, that he should challenge Hillary Clinton. He'd been saying those things on the campaign trail for weeks. That's not going to happen now, quite obviously. And again, that's another element of why this is, again, it's all good for the Democratic side and nothing good about this for the Republican side. And again, it's happened more quickly, and I think it bodes well. You'll see Hillary Clinton get a polling bump, I think, pretty quickly here if this all comes together on schedule as Democrats begin to come home, as Republicans have for Trump.
Yeah, Bernie Sanders and half his donors and half the Obama donors who haven't given to Hillary Clinton give to her. That's right. A serious piece of cash. Yep. Those two guys, I think, can be enlisted before too long. President Obama right away, Bernie Sanders before too long, to help her raise money. It puts even more pressure on Donald Trump. Clinton will now have Bernie Sanders, the Clintons, her husband, the Bidens, the Obamas, all out there. Donald Trump will have surrogates, but nobody at the level that she'll have.
Yes, totally right. And look, I think the money thing can't be underestimated. You know, we're going to talk later in the show about Trump's fundraising situation. But having Barack Obama and Bernie Sanders raising money for you, that's a big deal for the Clinton campaign. Wunderbar. Wunderbar for them and wunderbar for us, all right? We'll have more from our Bloomberg Politics interview, Jen Epstein's, that is, with Hillary Clinton next, what she said, former Secretary of State, that is, about Elizabeth Warren after this very quick break.
that Donald Trump has mentioned as a place that he wants to try to reach out to voters. So they're there, they're going, and Hillary Clinton said to me that she's really excited about it. You know, she has come from having Barack Obama be her biggest rival to being friends with him, and she seems to really be looking forward to having some fun, some joyful times on the campaign trail with him.
Also, just keep in mind, also a state that Barack Obama won emphatically in 2012, even though Paul Ryan was on the Republican ticket, and a state that Hillary Clinton lost in the Democratic nomination
Both
fight
true.
To Bernie Sanders, where she needs to kind of bolster herself there. Margaret, down in Washington today, tell us a little bit about what you witnessed there with Sanders. Obviously, everybody in the political world watched his statement to reporters, but give us a little sense of what the behind-the-scenes orchestration, the drama was around Senator Sanders' visit with President Obama.
It was really quite a choreography. We did know last night at the end of the day that Senator Sanders was expected, his aides expected him to come out to the stakeout location. And you could see that a few hours ago as like 75 reporters were gathered outside in the burning sun to wait. But, you know, it wasn't really clear until this morning when they began moving the press briefing back and back. And there was just that sort of magic vibe in the air that something was about to go down. This meeting with Sanders, which Sanders had requested, really was the last remaining obstacle to President Obama giving his endorsement. He had wanted to several days ago when he spoke with Senator Sanders on Sunday. That would have been the precursor to this endorsement, and President Obama was prepared really even before Tuesday night, but certainly after Tuesday night, to get out with this and move things forward. But it was the Clinton campaign that wanted to wait, feeling, and President Obama too, understanding the feeling that Senator Sanders wanted to have his own time and space to make the decision that he hasn't articulated yet, but that he is coming around to slowly but surely. And so it was a matter of giving him the deference of that meeting, talking about the grassroots, talking about Senator Sanders' ideas and how he could best move those forward, talking about the president's experience being the presumptive nominee, what he needed from Hillary Clinton 8 years ago, and trying to have that conversation to show Bernie Sanders a level of respect and inclusion that would sort of best position him to be able to go forward as part of the team. He's not quite there yet officially, but things are certainly moving in that direction.
Jennifer, talk about the human reality of the advantage that the Clinton campaign has of two of its top five officials, Jennifer Palmieri and John Podesta, used to be amongst the top officials in this White House.
Well, they've certainly been part of the conversations between the campaign and the White House going back to even before this campaign officially launched. You know, Podesta and Palmieri both left the White House not long before they joined the campaign. And since then, it's all kind of been this dynamic of, you know, that there's a constant conversations happening. And now I think we're just going to see this really, really seamless cooperation wherever and whenever and however President Obama can be used and Michelle Obama and the Bidens can be used to Hillary Clinton's advantage. You know, this is about the legacy of all the people in the current administration being able to carry it on and making sure that things like the Affordable Care Act don't get repealed, and that if anything, they're built upon and improved. And that's very much where their priorities lie moving forward.
So, Margaret, Hillary Clinton's operating kind of as the de facto heir apparent vice president, when in fact there's an actual vice president. He's got his own Bernie Sanders meeting today. What do you know about the role that Joe Biden has played in either brokering all this or being part of the discussion about how Team Obama goes forward now, easing Bernie Sanders out and working to help Hillary Clinton get elected?
Yeah, it's really interesting. That meeting has been underway at the Naval Observatory. We will see later tonight both Vice President Biden and Senator Elizabeth Warren speaking at a gathering of progressive legal activists and lawyers. We're not expecting either of them to make their endorsement there. We do understand that Senator Elizabeth Warren will make an endorsement tonight. Vice President Biden has a really special role because, of course, he didn't think that Hillary Clinton was best positioned as the Republicans' nominee several months ago. He wanted to run himself. He might very well have mounted that run himself if not for this period of time and the grieving for the passing of his son from brain cancer. And it has been a slow but steady path for Joe Biden to come around to being supportive of Hillary Clinton. He has kept his thumb off the scale. I don't think he will much longer, but he may be looking for a moment to make this sort of his own moment rather than to get ground in with the news of the day with President Obama and, you know, Senator Warren and everybody else. But Joe Biden's endorsement, when it comes, will be special because it will offer something different than what Senator Sanders can, and even different than what Barack Obama can. It will offer that working class white man's vote, in some circles at least, in some quarters and in some swaths of the country, most importantly, potentially, in the Rust Belt, in parts of Pennsylvania and Ohio.
Jim, we talked before, Mark and I did, about the power of having two of the greatest fundraisers in the history of fundraising, Bernie Sanders and Barack Obama, now out, about to soon, at some point in the immediate future, out raising money for Hillary Clinton. Just talk about the Clinton campaign is about to start turning to that in a serious way. There's been some news about them really trying to get the donors together this month and start really raising big money to try to take advantage of Trump's weakness there. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so there's already been some calls and some early meetings. Secretary Clinton is going to have another meeting in D.C. at her house with the big dollar bundlers, the people who are raising $500,000 or more for her. And I think that what they're going to try to do is just kind of have a big shock and awe month in June and then to move forward. I mean, they're looking at this billion-dollar plus total for all the Democratic fundraising efforts. You know, as much as Trump has played it down to us and saying maybe he's not even going to raise $500 million, the Democrats know that they have to play this in the traditional way. They want to have a field operation that's strong, not just for the top of the ticket, but for the House and Senate races, the gubernatorial races, and so on. And the fundraising is all part of that, and they can just get, you know, Obama, Sanders, and Vice President Biden and Michelle Obama out there fundraising, that can go a big way. You know, Hillary Clinton's only one person. Her campaign has already started to make it clear that they're going to have her mostly focusing on the stump and not fundraising.
Jennifer Epstein, Margaret Talib, you both are great, and thanks for coming on the show. Up next, John Kasich, the Republican governor of the state hosting the GOP convention next month, is not ready to endorse his party's standard bearer. We'll tell you why after this.
Welcome back. Over the past 24 hours or so, three leading Republicans, Speaker of the House Paul Ryan of Wisconsin, the Governor of Wisconsin, Scott Walker, and John Kasich, the Governor of the state of the Ohio, repudiated their presumptive nominee in the wake of his comments about the Mexican heritage of that federal judge. Among the many things Donald Trump has changed about U.S. electoral politics, this appears to be yet another new normal. On the spectrum of mildish criticism to scathing rebuke, here are just some of the sound bites that occur when a party's candidate for president is at odds with top figures in that same party.
His stage presence is something that's different than say, what I would do, but my my personal interactions, I find them to have very even-handed temperament. I think there's no justifying those comments, and I was very clear about that. And I think we all, everybody, not just Republicans, should disavow comments like that. And I'm glad he walked it back. This is a long campaign with a long way to go, and he has a ways to go to give us a campaign that we can all be proud of.
I'm frustrated right now. I think it's just wrong. I don't think it has any place in American society today. A lot of us expect, not as Republicans, but as Americans, that if you want to be viewed as a credible candidate, you need to make it clear that you don't associate with those beliefs.
The fact of the matter is that the qualities we need in a leader is very important to me. This is not a game for me. It's like I can't go.